Okay, so it is a pleasure today to have Eliska Greplova. So Eliska did a master in the group of Ignacio Sirac at the Max Planck Institute of Quantum Optics. And then she did a PhD at Aarhus University in the group of Klaus Molmer. And afterwards, a postdoc at ETH Zurich in the group of Sebastian Müller. So she's working on applying like machine learning techniques to a physical problem. And today she will present a talk entitled A Data-Driven Perspective on Quantum Matter. So the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Jorge Alexander, for the invite. Let me share the slide. So, okay, hopefully you see my slides now. I'm gonna put you guys on the screen so I can see you good. Yeah, so I see we are having, I also see a bunch of names that I recognize. I see that we are having a little bit smaller group today, so maybe let's just use this to chat about some interesting topics in quantum matter rather than I will talk at you for 45 minutes. So I think just like, let's say that you raise your hand and or just interrupt me at any time. And yeah. I titled this talk Data-Driven Perspective on Quantum Matter because somehow with this AI techniques rising, we have a lot of different applicational opportunities opening in a different like experimentally relevant and exciting fields. And it can sort of give some new perspectives on how we normally think about physics. So I wanted to specifically talk about like artificial intelligence, condensed matter, and quantum computing, which are the three fields that my group is working on. And I am super interested specifically in the how these fields overlap and how they can help each other, because they have been developing mostly independently over the last 3 or 4 decades. And now there is this exciting times that we have all these data-driven tools. So the things that are at the overlap are kind of fascinating to explore and see how these things can help each other. And since I wanted to formulate this as a talk for a broader audience, I'm also going to like try to formulate a lot of like bigger picture questions that are yet unanswered that remain to be explored and share them with you. And hopefully that can lead to some interesting discussions. So the sort of first thing that I want to quickly touch upon is this context, a concept of what I call a quantum big data, that the AI has been like super productive in dealing with like a large data sets everywhere from medical sector to advertising, but the physics is really different, right? In physics, you try to write the small toy models and understand like simple principles from those. So those two things are like potentially dramatically different. I see that some of you who are here also been in the Warsaw School, so you saw me doing this bit, but so let's just quickly go over this again. The central object in quantum mechanics, a quantum wave function, which is just like a vector in these complex Hilbert spaces, actually in itself doesn't scale super well, right? And because of this exponential scaling of your Hilbert spaces, you will quickly run into the problem that even if you have a simple toy model that you want to study, you cannot actually simulate it on a computer efficiently for the large system sizes. So the big data enters the quantum mechanics just because of your wave function sizes alone. And then there is a second question of access to the experimental measurements, right? Because these complex vectors in a Hilbert space, you cannot measure them. So what you do is that you measure what you can, and then you try to reconstruct the Hamiltonian or a wave function from those measurements. So these are kind of two counteracting, let's say, approaches where you collect a lot of data and try to build up a simple toy model, or you have a simple toy model, but then you need to put a huge numerical effort into maybe diagonalize it and then predict what the measurements results would be. So between these two things, we actually have a big data in quantum physics, because the wave functions are super data intensive, and because if we want to understand wave functions, we need to take even more data extensive measurements in a quantum experiments, because we cannot access wave function directly. We measure some indirect measurements, so it also requires a lot of data to reconstruct things afterwards. And now we are living in this really exciting time that where these things meet are these things in the cloud, which is the condensed matter experiments, quantum computing, quantum chemistry, all these things that are slowly becoming experimentally relevant, where you can test your simple toy models experimentally and then approach them from more of this data perspective. So now is this time where this intermediate scale quantum experiments are really relevant for a lot of things that we've been studying only theoretically in the past decades. And we have this data available. So the question is, what are we going to do with them? I wanna go back to this relationship of the AI and condensed matter and quantum computing, using one example, which is a quantum error correcting code that sort of sits in the middle of these three things. And I find this really fascinating, because you can look at the codes that correct errors in your quantum computer as a condensed matter problem that has a complicated Hamiltonian that you are trying to solve. You can also look at it as a purely algorithmic problem, as in it's an algorithm I will implement on my quantum computer. Or you can look at it as an artificial intelligence problem, where for the large scales, you need to implement these algorithms interactively with collecting a lot of data from your devices. So I like this example of quantum error correcting codes, because they kind of sit in the middle of these three disciplines. I'm now going to explain what I mean by that more specifically. So let's say that you have a qubit and it's in a spin up. Then some noise comes and it flips into the spin down state. And then you are done, right? And this is a noise that is not super controversial to happen in a quantum device. So even if the qubits were binary, a single thing like this happening on the chip that has many qubits is probably not super good for you. So then you can say, okay, I will be inspired by classical computing and I do this majority vote encoding. I encode my one spin into these three blue ones, then the noise comes and maybe it flips one. So if I do a majority vote, I will say, okay, it's still spin up and I celebrate, right? But of course, this is actually in the most first order roughest approximation that exists how classical computers correct the errors, even though there is much more sophisticated codes to do that. Now in a quantum device, it's not just up and down. There is superpositions, correlated noise, stuff like that. So it becomes pretty important. It becomes pretty complex. So a smart thing that Alexei Kitaev came up with, and I will have a phase transition in my slides from an emoji one to a little bit more complicated one, but I'm going to explain everything here, was to say, okay, why don't I encode my states into a ground state of a topological model where the information will be protected by some topological constraint of my ground state. And then I'm good, because the topology of the ground state will protect against a whole range of possible errors. So this is what people call quantum error correcting codes. And the most notorious example is the story code. You see that the Hamiltonian has two terms. One is the sum over the sigma x operators, which is this crosses that you see in the lattice, is just the four-body product of sigma x on the sigma x on the four spins. And the second one is the sum over all the possible placket operators in your lattice on the right, which is the product of the two sigma z's. So you basically just have a sum of these four, two four-body terms. Fun fact about this Hamiltonian, it's exactly solvable. So if it's a, in, if it's an implemented in an unperturbed way, you can actually write the ground state analytically, which is what I wrote here in a lower corner. Basically, very rough way how to think about it, if you are not familiar with this already, but I know that many of you are, is to think about that you would have to flip all the qubits along the red line or all the qubits along the blue line to switch between topologically degenerate ground states of this model. And if you wrap it on the torus, you will have four options of combinations of either having or not having this blue and red loops. So that allows you to encode two qubits. And basically leaving the topological security of this degenerate ground state happens to be pretty tricky because it's well separated from the first excited state. And you need to drive this model out of the topological phase to leave this degenerate manifold. Okay, so now we have these two basic ingredients that I wanted to be able to start telling you an interesting research stuff, which is the idea of just using data in quantum physics and the idea of this quantum error correcting codes, which I am going to be using as a toy model example for everything that that I want to explain today. So, okay, now there is this message in this part of, yeah, sorry. So in this first part, I want to kind of explain how.
Can I have a question, Eliska?
Yeah, of course.
Okay, so with the steric code, is it like a toy model and you can do two qubits and that's it? Or it's scalable? Like, I mean, I can imagine 3D maybe with three qubits, but can you go any higher or it's a more of a toy model?
Oh, it's... right, like this is like a one qubit encoding, as in like the ground state of this one model would be one logical qubit. So the scalability works like that. You just make a bigger lattices and each portion your lattice is a qubit or two and so on. But you are actually raising a really good point because this is not super scalable because you see that you need n squared physical spins to encode one qubit. So there are ideas to make this logarithmic scaling or something like that that are then difficult model wise, but it works just like that. Yeah. So this interplay now between condensed matter and quantum circuits or projective measurements. So let's say that I want to find a ground state that I want to experimentally engineer a ground state of this model. You have two options to think about it. Quantum circuit one or projective measurement one and Hamiltonian engineering one. If I start from an arbitrary state, let's say all zeros, and I will be projecting on this blue and red operators, eventually I will end up in the correct eigenstate of all of them, which happens to be the ground state of the model. So I'm going to explain this a little bit later on, but basically I just need to measure enough until I just statistically projected myself into the ground state. Or I can say I am actually going to, in the lattice, engineer these four-body interactions, and then just by energetical preferences of my system, it will sit down into the ground state by itself. And the state is going to be in is a perfect theoretical state because that's the one that is the energetically cheapest to sit in. So this is a picture from the Nature Physics paper from Andreas Wallraff lab from ETH, where they did this gate-based approach, and there is another nice Google experiment. Don't even ask me what all these gates mean here. They are super specific to their particular chip design. But basically, you see they start from some product states, and eventually, by doing all of these rotations and measurements, they say we end up, and we can verify that we can end up in a toric code ground state. So you begin from the arbitrary state, then you measure your operators, but there is a big but, which is sort of a scalability problem. So if you just keep randomly measuring your state, 50% of the time you will be ending up in a wrong subspace, right? Like if I have a rotating qubit and I wanna be in the space down, I can project on a sigma z. But sometimes I'm going to project on an up state that has a higher energy. And the same thing is happening here. So people use the so-called decoders that say, okay, I measured the wrong measurement outcome. So I write an algorithm that goes back and flip that specific qubit for me to point down again. And then you eventually arrive to the ground state. You just keep measuring and fixing your undesirable measurement outcomes. And this has been implemented experimentally successfully, but there are questions about how well this may scale, because you need to have this supercomputer that will keep translating all your quantum measurement errors. So the sort of second approach is to say, okay, I will just engineer the Hamiltonian. That means that if I do that, I will be in the ground states of whatever I have engineered. And if I engineered something slightly wrong, I can just measure my state, learn the parameters of the Hamiltonian, and correct all the imprecisions in the ground state. And sort of there is now this super beautiful thing about this condensed matter point of view of looking at trying to actually engineer the Hamiltonian instead of trying to do the quantum circuits and trying to play guacamole with the errors as they keep popping up. So there is this amazing paper that I have in the corner from Claudio Chamon and Claudio Castello. And they realized that you can introduce sigma z or sigma x errors or perturbations to the toric code in a way that the ground state stays analytically solvable. Exactly solvable. So if I introduce a noise in this very specific, very suspiciously looking exponential way, what it boils down to is that you sort of introduce the noise placket-wise or crosswise, I can keep my ground state exactly solvable. So it's very easy for me to introduce this noise and simulate arbitrary size lattices. And then I have here on the right of the slide, just built a neural network that takes the correlators from those lattices and maps on the parameters of my Hamiltonian. I know the parameters, so then I can correct them, and so on. Fun fact that we did is that we trained on this errors that keep your condensed matter model analytical. And then we applied it to the errors that would not keep it analytical, just like, you know, errors that would be more perturbation of your model that would be more arbitrary. And then we basically, in iterations, we would prepare a ground state of the toric code that is not analytically solvable. We would apply a neural network that would estimate all these Hamiltonian coefficients, adjust them, prepare a new ground state, and repeat. And we would have this kind of iterative method. And what happens is that in 5 iteration here, you have a single qubit error on a probability of single qubit error on the logarithmic scale and iteration of our protocol on the x-axis. And basically, you see that for the different types of errors, I arrive in 5 iteration to the like really perfect toric code ground state when the probability of getting single error is 10^-4. So really, really low, which also means that you could encode those logical qubits with a small amount of physical qubits eventually. So this was kind of like a fun observation, and we could do this. This is of course all simulated data, but this is an algorithm that could then be applied on the measurements from the larger chips, because I can always train it on the perturbations of my model that translate into an exactly solvable ground state. And then it seems to be working fine on the different type of perturbations. So it's sort of a way to approach the scalable decoding and implementation of this error correcting code. So this is just like one insight that I wanted to share that I found really nice, that you can train your machine learning model. You can be smart about building your condensed matter model for your problem, train your ML model on that, and then see how well it generalizes. So here, just like some open questions that I wanted to share, is like, for me, it's a very open question, like when it's best to use quantum circuits and when the Hamiltonian engineering, because in a different problems, you will have different sources of errors. And sometimes you need maybe low amount of non-Clifford gates or two-qubit gates, so a quantum circuit is preferable. Sometimes the Hamiltonian engineering on the chip or in the optical lattice or whatever can be more beneficial, because the system by itself will arrive to the state that you want, and you don't need any kind of additional error correction. So for me, this interplay between the CONMAT model and the quantum circuit model was pretty interesting, and it came to be just because we can build a machine learning mapping between the ground state and the parameters of your Hamiltonian that generalizes really, really well. Another question here is like, whether like Hamiltonian learning in general can meaningfully supplement quantum circuits and quantum algorithms. And in general, I would be like looking forward, I would be interested in coming up with general way to just use a condensed matter insights in a quantum algorithm design, because before you think about compiling everything into a single and two-qubit gates, there is this very fundamental insights about solvability and stuff like that, that actually the condensed matter models possess that you will never see in the circuit models. So this was the sort of like a most like really like a pure physics part of my presentation. Now I want to move on another example that is at the boundary of AI and condensed matter. So this time, instead of thinking about implementing a code or implementing a specific Hamiltonian, I want to talk about approximating quantum states. It's about the thing that I showed at the beginning of my presentation. Basically, it scales badly and we cannot solve things exactly because they scale badly. And so people came up again with like over many decades now. This Jastrow paper is from 1955. Oh my God. But like with different approximative methods that pretty much work similarly. You prepare some ansatz that approximate your wave functions just well enough to keep it down to a polynomial number of coefficients, and then you optimize the ansatz based on the variational principle. And basically you have two ways to go around it. You can be very physics informed and prepare your ansatz in a way that it reflects your physics knowledge about your system. And there would this like Slater-Jastrow model or even the area law techniques would kind of fall into that category. And then there is the more generic approach, which is to use neural networks where you don't use any input about physics of your system, but you have one sort of one fits all kind of ansatz. And these ansatzes are really interesting because then they are harder to fine tune and actually solve the problems because they are so general, but they also have proven to go beyond the, for example, area law, which is the only things that the tensor networks can approximate. So this is now pretty exciting, like area of the research. In terms of which neural networks you can use, there is a huge range of different options. There is restricted Boltzmann machines, which is the work of Giuseppe and Matthias that started it all in 2017. But people have built very deep network, either just feed forward or with convolutions. Lately, there is this like recurrent networks that you can use or attention-based mechanism. So there is a lot. We did something in the direction of modifying the first one. So let's take the restricted Boltzmann machine, which is just a two-layer neural network, which has a hidden and visible layer, and it's parameterized by the parameters on the weights, and the neurons themselves have some bias parameters that characterize them. And basically what you do is that you parameterize your wave function by the network, and then you use the variational principle to minimize the ansatz, as in adjust the weights and biases, and you do it, for example, by using stochastic reconfiguration or other techniques. But really, we don't have to think about these technicalities. We just know that we take this thing as our wave function and we minimize the energy of that using the variational principle. But now what? If you are in a Hilbert space, this is again going to be, you are going to be limited what kind of states you can characterize with the polynomial number of coefficients in your variational approximation. So what you can do is that you keep adding parameters. And what happens when you do that, that the blue blob in the Hilbert space you can approximate efficiently keeps growing. But there are instances when your actual ground state in a very hard models is going to sit a sort of little bit outside of that. And this is sort of like a problem with these generic networks, because you don't have a very like a physics guided way to adjust them. You may keep adding parameters, and eventually you start adding too much and it will stop scaling well. So that's sort of like a problem people keep running into in the context of these problems. So what we did, This was amazing work by Agnes, was to try to inject a little bit of physics back into this by introducing the correlator restricted Boltzmann machines. And basically the idea here is this. So we know the Hamiltonian we are trying to solve, right? And the Hamiltonian has some terms that relay on interactions or correlations in that system. So we say, let's introduce extra neurons in the visible layer in a way that the layer will actually capture the meaningful correlations in the system. So for example, you see that I have a between the original yellow neuron S1, S2, I have a neuron that is just a product of S1, S2. So that would be just like a two-body correlator. And then in the middle of the square, I have a neuron which will be product of all the yellow ones. So now I'm calculating four body products. So you can already tell that where we are going with this, and that's solving a harder instances of the historic code. It so happens that if you introduce external fields or some really difficult perturbation to the historic code Hamiltonian that I explained to you before, those states are really, really hard to capture variationally. And basically what happens is that they are such that you cannot really capture them by increasing the number of hidden neurons. So this overall, the toric code, if you consider in full generality what kind of fields and perturbations you can introduce, the phase diagram gets pretty complicated. I will refer to you to our paper if you want to look into it deeper, but just for the case of this talk, there is just like a cut in the y direction through this phase diagram. And you see that on the first plot that the ground state value, energy value keeps decreasing with the increased field, but the RBM cannot capture it. And the RBM cannot capture it even if we keep increasing the number of hidden neurons. And then look what happens when we add these correlators. Basically, we capture the energy pretty precisely. We get 10 to the 5 kind of precision, which is like, you know, this really state of art variational techniques that people have developing for many years now can do even better. But this gets very close. And it's just a simple trick to say, okay, look, I have a four-body correlation in my Hamiltonian. So I just do that on my variational ansatz as well. And then those extra weights, the orange ones that connect the new correlation neurons to the hidden layer, are just enough to actually capture the sort of correlation features in the ground states and help us approximate these states in a much bigger way. So that's what I wanted to show here. So yeah, here is again this like struggle between doing a physics-informed thing and doing a fully general thing. So can we find some compromise where we inject a little bit of physics without actually compromising the full generality of that ansatz? And the another question is that all these machine learning models have all these interpretational challenges. But again, we have people in the audience who are working hard towards solving that. But yeah, it's like, it's just like very interesting questions of like how much physics knowledge we can input into the AI model to really assist with this sort of interpretability. This was really interesting for us here because again, that specific weight that goes from a four body correlator in my neural network means something, right? Like, so this is something that is very interesting for me. And then like a most general question of all here is like, what is the right compromise between going completely black box AI and being enough specific for the physics. Okay, the last thing I want to show you is sort of at the boundary of AI and quantum computing, and it's sort of tangentially related to this variational approaches. And that's the following. So if we think back to this quantum circuits that I was showing you in the context of the Torrey code model. Not every quantum circuit you cannot simulate classically in a polynomial time. In fact, a lot of them you can. And there is just a small subset of gates that make the things quantum. But then the hard question is, if you have a picture, if you have a quantum circuit, like to characterize the quantumness or a quantum computational complexity of your final state with a single number, because so the pink ones here are the T gates. Those are the ones that cannot be simulated, whose effect cannot be simulated classically. It will radically change if I would shift one T gate and put it into the previous layer, right? It's a on which qubit it is and at which position it is in the circuit, it will generate a dramatically different states. So sort of characterizing a quantumness of the state based on how this sort of classically simulatable Clifford and not classically simulatable non-Clifford gates comes into play is a big open question. And you can see that it's a hard optimizational question, right? Because if I have a five pink gates here, I have so many options to put them with respect to the qubits and layer, and each of those options will generate a state that is different and could be differently complex, as in differently quantum. So what people are doing is to calculate the so-called magical monotones. One of them is called MANA. I am not going to show the formula here because it's horrible, but like just to get some kind of intuition of how that works is that, so we start from the state that is the black one and a black dot on the right that has MANA zero. I do two Clifford gates, MANA stays zero. I go one more Clifford gate on the first qubit, MANA stays zero. But then I do this T gate, the non-Clifford gate, and MANA suddenly jumps up. And then I do a next one and MANA jumps up again. And then I do another Clifford and it stays the same. So it's like a way to translate into a number that monotonically increases with your amount of quantumness, how like quantum that state you are generating is. So in relation to this, okay, now we are using a slightly different Hamiltonian. It's sort of in a similar family like the story codes, but there is a technical thing that you can only calculate MANA for odd dimensional Hilbert spaces. So you actually need to use Q-trits and it becomes a whole thing, but let's not worry about that. There is a funny observation that my student Arash made, which is really fascinating. So in the top row, you have a values of energy. Orange is exact and green is from the RBM. And to the right, we are increasing number of neurons in the hidden layer. So eventually your approximated energy becomes very close to your exact one for this Hamiltonian ground state. When I am calculating the mana, though, this quantumness of the state, the same thing does not happen even for the state in your lower right corner that has the most hidden neurons. So basically think about what this means now. And this completely shocked me when I realized this. The state that we say is a computationally scalable, good variational approximation of a really, really difficult quantum state has a more quantumness in it. It would take a circuit with more T gates to prepare the approximation than to prepare the original state, right? And that's completely crazy, but actually it's just the natural consequence of the fact that I keep variationally minimizing in my Hilbert space. And if I'm just a little bit off, just statistically, I am going to be in a higher entanglement or higher quantum complexity state because Hilbert space is mostly those. And the nice ones that are well approximatable are just this small corner, as people keep calling it. So variationally minimizing the energy, I am sort of just going to sit somewhere, and that somewhere may very well be more quantum computationally demanding than the state I am looking for. So this is super much like a work in progress. I just wanted to flash this here as a maybe inspiring point for the future discussions. Specifically, if we keep just minimizing energy to approximate the ground states, we will always run into this kind of problems. But at the same time, it's very easy because variational principle is simple. It's simple to understand, and then it's simple to optimize the gradient stuff. But at the same time, so what we are exploring now in my group is to how can we employ the quantum complexity considerations for this variational approaches, because we should sort of look at also, there are other properties of the state than just energy that tells you how close you are to the state that you are looking for. So this is something that is very, very interesting for us at the moment, but we don't have a super concrete answers on how to solve all of these things. Yeah, so I am slowly getting to the end. So I wanted to show you some examples of the research that is going on in my group. So some things between condensed matter and quantum computing are these questions of actually using condensed matter insights in a sensible manner for quantum algorithms to help with the scaling and stuff. Then there was this question of using neural networks as a condensed matter quantum states and kind of using the interplay of a little bit of the physics knowledge that I knew anyways, because I knew the Hamiltonian that I am diagonalizing into the black box AI approach and see how much that can help. And the final thing is to bring also the quantum computing back to the using neural networks as a quantum state, because quantum computational demands have been actually very well characterized on a quantum information theory side. So I think there is a lot of interesting questions towards how can we employ these in a way to approximate the interesting quantum states in a most meaningful way. I want to also, this I didn't have time to talk about, but I also want to give a quick teaser about other research that is going on in my group that I am very excited about, which is automated control of quantum devices. Basically, nowadays, you see all of these exciting, really big quantum chips that are potentially doing something that is too hard for a classical computers to simulate. And maybe then there is amazing progress in the numerical simulation field, but then you add one qubit and it will need, another 3 months of amazing progress to catch up. So this is really exciting time, as I was saying. One catch though, controlling those experiments is a real and total nightmare. And a lot of our experimental partners basically have an experienced student or postdoc attached to them the whole time, because it's not a simple threshold current question to tune up your quantum gate, it requires a lot of knowledge and intuition and just like visual analysis of the measurements to do that quickly and properly. So like a long-term trend for us has been to look into solving this challenge. So in the past, we've answered successfully some of those questions about fully handing on the control to the AI for tuning quantum dot chips with just like doing image processing analysis on those measurements, as well for different two-dimensional materials like graphene. And now again, work in progress that is hopefully coming up soon is to do the same for quantum communications when you are creating long distance entangled states for the quantum internet links. So that's just like a kind of highlight, something we are working on, because the more qubits you have, the more months you need to stand there turning buttons. So my vision for this is to get this automated so we can also scale the qubit chips to the bigger sizes than we have now. With that, I am done. What I was talking about in the main parts of my talk, that was work by my students Agnes and Arash. And I also want to acknowledge my other collaborators on this project, Aver, Sebastian, and Nathanael, and thank you very much for listening. And I am looking forward to the questions.
Thank you very much. I will then stop the recording now, and then we can go for the questions.